Welcome students. In today's session, we will learn steps for problem solving. So basically the problem solving means, suppose if there is given a problem and we want to solve that particular problem using a computerized method by writing a certain programs, then what are the steps involved at the high level? How should we go ahead in order to provide the solution for the given problem? The problem could be something like, say a student has scored certain marks in a particular examination. Consider your previous examination, that is PUC2. You had say 6 subjects. Okay, the problem here is that we need to find out the total marks obtained by you and the percentage. Okay, as simple as I'm just considering a simple example here. In this problem, we need to solve it using the computerized method by writing a particular program in a particular programming language. Okay, so what are the steps involved in solving that particular problem? We will be learning in this particular session. So basically there are certain steps involved in the solving a given particular problem, and the steps are like this. The first step is that define that particular problem, that is problem definition, then problem analysis, then design, coding, and then testing and debugging, and the last step is documentation and maintenance. These steps are a general steps which can be used to solve any given particular problem. Sometimes we call these steps as the problem solving methodologies. Okay, certain type of a kind of a template or the steps we need to go through each of these particular steps in order to solve a given problem. So each of these steps we are going to learn one by one in detail. The first one is the problem definition. So the problem definition means we need to first come up with the we need to understand the given problem very well. What is the given problem and what is the solution we need to provide for that one? If we don't understand the given problem correctly, then probably it may happen that we will end up in giving a particular solution, and that solution will not be feasible for the given problem. For example, as I had taken in the previous example, suppose if we are planning to calculate the total for a given subjects, okay, assume that we initially thought that there will be a 6 subjects. Basically there will be a 6 subjects, and our assumption is wrong. We did not understood the problem and we thought that okay, there will be only 5 subjects. Then according to that, if you go ahead and calculate the total and the percentage, definitely the solution what we will achieve at the end will be wrong as per the given problem. So understanding the problem is very much essential. Okay, we need to define that particular problem in detail and understand what solution we are going to provide it for. Okay, so that is definition of the problem. So for an user or a programmer, the definition of the problem should be very well understood, then only we can proceed further. If there are any problems in understanding the definition itself, the programmer should get the clear picture of the what problem is, okay, how we are going to solve that particular problem. Fine. Second step will involve the analysis of the problem. So analysis in the sense, as you can see there, the problem may be having certain set of inputs. Okay, as you know, the computer, we need, in order to calculate certain task by the computer, we have to provide certain set of inputs. So those inputs we call it as a raw data, and based upon the program what we have written, based upon the process, the computer would be returning or resulting back the outputs. Now analysis of this input and output means what type of input we are providing. Okay, we have studied the inputs. Inputs are nothing but the raw facts. Raw facts could be what? It could be a text format, it could be a number, numbers, or it could be even a voice messages, or it could be a videos. Okay, it could be any type of raw facts. So we need to analyze what type of input we are providing it to the program or the in order to solve the problem. What are the different types of inputs are there? Okay, how many inputs are there? Suppose if we go in detail, suppose if there is an numbers, the number could be a real number or it could be a integer number or it could even have a certain fractional parts in that one. So what type of input we are providing it to the program, so that in detail we need to study about the inputs. Then outputs, in which particular type we need to provide the output, or that is the results. Should we provide it in a, again, the textual format, or should we give it in a graphical representation, or it should be given as an video or an audio? What type of output the user is in requirement when we solve the given problem? So the analysis of the problem has to be done here with respect to the inputs and outputs. Along with this, the analyzing the input and output, we need to even focus on certain additional requirements. So additional requirement could be that, for an example, what type of programming languages we are going to use in order to solve this particular problem. Okay, so all those sorts of the analysis we need to do before we begin with the next steps. Okay, so in the first step, what we had studied, in the first step is the understanding the problem. Once we understood the problem correctly, then we can go with the next step, that is analysis of that particular problem, wherein we will try to focus on analyzing the inputs, what type of input we will have, and what type of the output we have to produce by writing the program, and what type of the technique we are going to use, say what type of programming languages we will be using. So like that, we need to analyze here. Okay, that will be covered in the second step, that is problem analysis. Step is design. So design is nothing but a kind of a blueprint we need to come up with. Okay. Now you might have heard, or you might have seen before, say if a particular building, a constructor wants to build a building, before he starts actually constructing, he will be making a kind of a prototype. Prototype in the sense, he would be making a kind of a blueprint, how it should be built. Okay. What are the things have to be taken care of? So like that, we need to even design. Before we start programming, we need to design what are the things we have to go for. Means what are the steps involved in designing that particular program. So basically this design can be done in various methods. Couple of methods I have put here. The first one is an algorithm and the second is a flowchart. Algorithm means these are nothing but the step-by-step procedure. Step-by-step procedure in the sense, suppose if the problem is there and I have understood the problem and analyzed the problem, then how do I go ahead with the solution? So those solutions I will be writing in a step-by-step procedures. Procedures in the sense, if you can consider it as a sentences. Okay, in first step I would be mentioning, I guess, step one. In step one I will be doing so and so activity. Step two I will be doing so and so activity. Okay, I will give an example and explain it with an example. Okay, then the second type of design could be what? The flowchart. Okay, flowchart in the sense, we need to provide the solution, we need to write the solution in a pictures or a diagrammatic representation. Okay, you know, diagrams speak much better way than the text format, right? So even when we have the design, the algorithm, that algorithm we can convert it into a pictorial representation or a diagrammatic representation, wherein that particular, when we look into that particular diagram, we can come to know that what is the solution we are going for, how we need to provide the solution for the that particular problem. Let us see one example here. I have taken one example of the calculation of an area, okay, of a circle. Suppose if we want the problem, this is very basic, very simple example. Okay, now problem is what? Calculate the area of circle. Say we have assumed that our problem, we understood really well about the what problem definition is, and then we even analyze the input. Okay, input analyze means we have gone through what are the different types of input we require and what are the outputs required. Now here, if you think of input, input could be what? It could be the radius, right? We need the radius of a particular circle whose area we are going to calculate for. Okay, then output could be what? Again, output could be what? We are going to display the in a number format, in a figure. So this is going to be the area of a given circle whose radius is so and so. So over here, the additional requirement could be what? The value of a pi which we will require during the calculation. So that can be a additional requirement, or the programming language using which we are going to solve this particular problem. That could be the additional requirement. Then the algorithm and a flowchart, which are part of the design. Now, in the algorithm, as I said, these are the step-by-step procedures for a particular solution. So you may see that in the basic writing the algorithm, the first step is always a start, and the last step is going to be a stop. Okay. So within that, we will be writing our steps. Okay. First, we start it. Then second is that we need to know what is the value of the radius. Whose area we are going to find out. So we need to read that particular value, and we call it as an R variable, a kind of a container where we are going to store that particular value. So R radius we need to read from the user. Once the radius is read, next step is what? We need to make use of the pi value. Say in this case, I'm going to use the pi value as 3.14. Or else if you want to go with a 3.142 or any other further fractions, we can take it out. So we need to set a pi value. Okay. Suppose if I want to set it for a 3.14, I can do it as pi is equals to 3.14. That means in the next calculation, when I denote pi, that is pi, the value of the pi is going to be what? 3.14. Okay. So I read the radius, then I set the value of pi, and then the next step is what? I need to really calculate what is the area. So the formula for area calculation is, area of a circle is what? Area is equals to pi r square. So r square is nothing but r into r. So that is how I am going to calculate with respect to the programming language. So with respect to that, I need to write a statement saying that calculate area, which is equals to nothing but pi into r into r. So this pi value I have already set here to 3.14, and the r value which I have already read from the user, say if the radius is a 2 centimeter or a 3 inches, whatever it could be the value which I have read. So using that r and this pi, I'm going to calculate the area. Okay. So once the calculation is done, what has to be done? I need to display that particular area onto the screen, onto the monitor, say. Okay. Then I will be writing a statement print r, area. So what it indicates, print r, area? Nothing but the area of a circle whose radius is so and so, the area will be this much. Like that, we will be displaying a state message on the monitor, on the screen, right? With respect to that one, I will be writing a step, that is print radius as well as the area which we have calculated. Okay. And then the last step is stop. So the step by step, we will proceed further and try to find out or try to write the procedural information about how we are going to solve the given problem. That is a design. So this we call it as a design in terms of algorithm. Once this algorithm is there, we can convert this algorithm into a pictorial representation. Pictorial representation means what? The each of the values or the statements what we have written, that is start, or it could be reading the values or setting up certain formulas or calculating the area or printing the area. So all these we need to convert into a pictorial representation. Why basically pictorial representation? Because picture speaks more when we compare to the text format. When I look into this particular picture, I can see that there are certain steps involved here. What are the steps? There is a start, there is some option called as a activity called as a read R. Okay. And these two are what? These are connected with an arrow mark. So what this particular arrow says? So I'm starting from this process, then I'm going to the next process like this. So the arrow indicates the flow of the execution here, or the flow of the work, basically the workflow of each of the task, right? So each of these algorithm, each steps of the algorithm are converted into a diagrammatic representation here. So read value of R. So that is shortened and written as read R here. Okay. Then set pi equals to 3.14. So what I have written here in the picture, pi is equals to 3.14. That means I have to give a value 3.14 to the pi. Then calculate the area using this particular formula and proceed to the next step. Or the next process. Next process involves the printing of the R and the area, and then stop it. So the again, this particular flowchart, what it indicates? It indicates a design, okay, a kind of a blueprint, okay, using which I will be writing a program, which will be covered in the next step. Okay, I hope that this particular step is understood, that is designing. In designing, we just try to provide the solution to the given problem with respect to either in an algorithm format or with respect to in the flowchart format. In the algorithm, we try to describe that particular solution in a step-by-step statements, simple statements. Okay, if it is a flowchart, then the algorithm, we need to convert it into a diagrammatic representation. Okay, in detail we are going to study this algorithm and flowchart in the upcoming sessions. Okay, this is just a simple example I have taken. In the flowchart, each of these shapes, basically what you see here, a oval or a rectangle or a parallelogram, what we see, each of them have a particular meaning. So we will be studying in detail in the upcoming sessions. Okay, so I hope this particular phase or a step is understood, that is design step. The next one is coding or the real programming. Based upon the design what we have done, that is, it could be an algorithm or it could be a flowchart, that particular design we have to translate or convert into a programming language. Okay, programming languages could be, it could be any of the type which we have gone through earlier. It could be a low level, it could be a high level, but we are going to look into only high level programming languages. And in this particular semester, as you know that we will be learning C programming, so the algorithms and the flowchart which are done as part of the design will be converted into a C programming languages. Okay, so basically the programming means nothing but the it's a process of writing the program instructions. So for each of the statements what we written here, for each of the statements what we have written in the previous each of those steps we will be trying to convert into a proper programming language instructions or the statements with respect to a particular programming language. So once the programming is completed, we need to verify that particular program, whether that particular, when we execute that program, is it giving the correct answers or no, right? We need to test the program. Okay, and we need to even debug the program. So test means what? Check whether the program works according to the requirement of the user. So what is the meaning of this one? Say, if I take the previous example, that is calculation of the area of a circle. Let me take a different example here. It would be very simple. If I take a area of a circle, let me take the calculation of a total and the percentage of a marks of a particular student. Okay. Now, when I execute the program with respect to the design and the code what I have developed, and when I get the results, is it giving me the correct results or no? Okay, say it could be that it could happen that I am reading 6 subject marks but calculating what? The sum of only 5 subjects. I am omitting, I am just rejecting, or I may not be considering the one particular subject there. I would have missed to consider one particular subject while calculation. Okay, and when the results appear, the result is going to be a something mistake there, right? The result may not be appropriate. So we need to verify whether the result is correct or wrong. So if it is wrong, that is what we need to do the debugging. If there are any problems, okay, we need to remove all those errors or the bugs. Basically, the errors could be of different types here. Errors could be of different types. We will study these errors once we begin with the programming. Okay, errors could be of type a syntax errors, a runtime error, a semantic error, or a logic error. Just remember these words, the types of errors. In detail, each of these errors with an example we will study once we proceed with respect to the writing the programs. Okay, so basically testing and debugging means we will verify whether the program which we have written, whether it works correctly or not. If it is not working correctly, then debug it. Debug means try to solve those particular problems or the errors which are there in the program. Okay, we need to debug until the program gives us the correct values or correct results. Okay, that will be in the this particular step. Step is documentation and maintenance. So basically, documentation and maintenance means documentation in the sense, what are the design we have taken care of? Okay, what type of the problem it was? Okay, what are the steps we have taken in order to give the solution? About kind of a documentation, okay, we need to provide here. Basically, kind of a in a text format, we are going to provide a reference materials. Okay, like how when you are studying the particular programming or any subject, after we study that particular subject, what the teachers will do? Teachers will provide you the notes. So what that particular notes will do? It will act as a documentation for your further studies for the sake of examination. In the same way, whenever we write a particular program, any program or a software you consider, right, we need to provide a documentation of that. That documentation may tell that how to use that particular program, okay, what type of input you need to provide, what type of output it generates, or it could be that the design, the code, how we have written, what is the basic design we have used in writing the code. So all sort of the reference materials it provides. Okay, the maintenance is something in future. Suppose if you want to modify the program, in the sense, we could have, if I take the previous example, that is the area of a circle. Okay, now in future, say I have written a program to calculate a area of a circle. In future, I want to make certain modification as part of my maintenance. In that maintenance, I will take up some additional feature in the sense, along with calculation of the area, I will try to calculate the circumference of the circle also. Okay, so I need to include those mechanisms also. In future, if I want to modify the program based upon the user requirements, then the problem or the solution what we have done, it should be able to achieve, or it should be able to take up those particular things also. So the documentation and maintenance of the particular solution what we have find out should be there. So these are the steps, students, the problem solving steps in general. Okay, we will be few of the steps over here. Start. That is, we will study the algorithm and flowchart, and obviously the third part, that is writing the program. And if we write the program, we will try to validate our program by testing. And if there are any errors, we will try to debug it. Okay, and certain sort of documentation we will also learn throughout this particular subject. Okay, I hope students the concepts of solving the given problem, the steps for solving a problem is understood. Okay, if there are any doubts, you may just put up the comments here.